All right, well, we've been in a series called Summer in the Psalms, and this is the second to last week. Next week will be our last week in the Psalms. We have been looking at Book 2 of the Psalms. So the Psalms were written over the course of nearly 1,000 years, and then later they were arranged and compiled into 5 different books, and it sort of correlates to the 5 books of the Torah. And these Psalms, they're Hebrew poetry, they're prayers, and their songs, and perhaps even journal entries, and a lot of them became part of sort of the hymnal of the Israelite community. They became a part of their corporate worship, and so they're intended to be sung. But within this genre of Hebrew poetry, there are a lot of different types of psalms. Now, this is a review if you've been here, missing this, I think, first week, but I want to simplify it and go over it one more time, just as a refresher. Scholars don't fully agree on how they would categorize the Psalms, because some of them have different elements, but I sort of made up my own way of looking at them, and I distilled it down to 3 types with some subtypes. And so I think there's is there a graph for this? Yes, okay. Not a graph, a table. So there's wisdom psalms, lament psalms, and praise psalms. And then within the wisdom category, you might find just a wisdom psalm or a declaration of trust or a psalm that gives instruction. These psalms sound a little bit like the book of Proverbs. They're very similar. Then there's lament psalms. And there's penitential or confession. Psalm 51, David's confession, that was a penitential lament. There's corporate or individual lament. Psalm 42 and 43 we looked at this series. Those are individual lament psalms. And then today we're going to be looking at an imprecatory or cursing psalm. It's going to be real fun. But there's praise. There are praise psalms, praise or hymn of praise. Last week we looked at a hymn of praise, thanksgiving or remembrance, historical, where they look back on how God was faithful in the past, and the psalm recounts his activity, a kingship or royal psalm about the Israel's king in Zion, the king of Judah, and then these psalms of confidence. But I already left the cat out of the bag. We're going to be talking about the imprecatory psalm. One of the cool things about the book of Psalms is that the first 3 books are predominantly filled with lament, and then the last 2 are predominantly filled with praise psalms. And so if you were to take the book as a whole, you will go from mourning to joy, from lament to praise, from death to resurrection. And that's really cool if you take it, you know, in whole. But we're looking at Book 2. And Book 2 is filled with a lot of laments. And we've looked at several already in the series, and it's like, man, this is kind of a downer, like Summer in the Psalms. We're just spending summer in lament. And then it doesn't really get any better, because I come to the psalm that I was planning to preach on today, and I'm like, oh man, I don't know if I want to do this, like, because this is an imprecatory or cursing psalm. These are not my favorite psalms, to say the least. They are uncomfortable. They feel wrong. Sometimes they're actually just downright horrifying. I'll give you an example. You've maybe read this if you've read through the psalms, but I don't know if, I'd be curious as how many of you it actually sunk in what this says, but one of the most horrifying psalms is Psalm 137. It ends this way. Happy is the one who seizes your infants and dashes them against the rocks. That's in Psalm 137. That's how it ends. I mean, what is that doing in the Bible? Happy is the one who seizes your infants and dashes them against the rocks. That's horrifying, and it's in the Bible. Now, there's some context around Psalm 137. It's during the Babylonian captivity, and the Israelites, they're lamenting their captivity, and they're lamenting the brutality of the Babylonian Empire as they conquered them. And they're saying, it's a declaration of a desire for revenge. Happy is the one who does to you what you've done to us in your war and violence and brutality. So there's a little bit of context, but I'm going to be honest with you, it doesn't really make it feel any better. It's like still pretty horrible. That whole sentence is just, could we just like scratch that out of the Bible? And here's the thing, that's in Book 5 of the Psalms, and we're not going to preach from Book 5 until summer 2026, so we're just going to move on, and I'm not going to spend any more time in Psalm 137. But you can see why these imprecatory psalms are like uncomfortable. They feel wrong. And so it raises this question, how are we as Christians who are taught by Jesus, like these are the words of Jesus, love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you. And Paul talks about, do not repay anyone for evil. How are we supposed to read these psalms that include these just potent statements of revenge and just hatred? I don't know, actually, so that's all for today. You can go now. No, I'm just kidding. We're going to talk about it. We're going to look at Psalm 69. I'm also going to warn you, it's a very long psalm. Need to fill space in the sermon, you know. Before we read it, I want to share with you a little bit about the outline, or like a structure, because these lament Christian psalms, they have a structure. And I'm going to share it with you, and then maybe if you notice it as we read it, it'll stick out to you. So usually it begins with an invocation or an address to call upon, and then a complaint or the lament, and then a plea for help. God help, then a cursing. God punish them. So help me punish them. And then a declaration of confidence, and then a hymn of praise. And this is sort of the structure that a lament psalm will follow. And so I want to see, if you have Bibles or devices and you'd like to read along, you can. It will also be on the screen, if that's easier for you to see. But I'd be curious if you identify these elements. And I'm going to warn you again, this is a very long psalm, and so I might lose some of you. That's okay. Maybe the Holy Spirit will wake you up. Psalm 69, we're going to begin in verse 1. For the director of music, to the tune of lilies of David. Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sink in the miry depths where there is no foothold. I have come into the deep waters, the floods engulf me. I am worn out calling for help. My throat is parched. My eyes fail looking for my God. Those who hate me without reason outnumber the hairs of my head. Many are my enemies without cause, those who seek to destroy me. I am forced to restore what I did not steal. You, God, know my folly. My guilt is not hidden from you. Lord, the Lord Almighty, may those who hope in you not be disgraced because of me. God of Israel, may those who seek you not be put to shame because of me. For I endure scorn for your sake, and shame covers my face. I am a foreigner to my own family, a stranger to my own mother's children. For zeal for your house consumes me, and the insults of those who insult you fall upon me. When I weep and fast, I must endure scorn. When I put on sackcloth, people make sport of me. Those who sit at the gate mock me, and I am the song of the drunkards. But I pray to you, Lord, in the time of your favor, in your great love, O God, answer me with your sure salvation. Rescue me from the mire. Do not let me sink. Deliver me from those who hate me, from the deep waters. Do not let the flood waters engulf me, or the depth swallow me up, or the pit close its mouth over me. Answer me, Lord. Out of the goodness of your love and your great mercy, turn to me. Do not hide your face from your servant. Answer me quickly, for I am in trouble. Come near and rescue me. Deliver me because of my foes. You know how I am scorned, disgraced, and shamed. All my enemies are before you. Scorn has broken my heart and has left me helpless. I looked for sympathy, but there was none. For comforters, but I found none. They put gall in my food and gave me vinegar for my thirst. May the table set before them become a snare. May it become retribution and a trap. May their eyes be darkened so they cannot see, and their backs be bent forever. Pour out your wrath on them. Let your fierce anger overtake them. May their place be deserted. Let there be no one to dwell in their tents. For they persecute those you wound and talk about the pain of those you hurt. Charge them with crime upon crime. Do not let them share in your salvation. May they be blotted out of the book of life and not be listed with the righteous. But as for me, afflicted and in pain, may your salvation, God, protect me. I will praise God's name in song and glorify him with thanksgiving. This will please the Lord more than an ox, more than a bull with its horns and hooves. The poor will see and be glad. You who seek God, may your hearts live. The Lord hears the needy and does not despise his captive people. Let heaven and earth praise him, the seas and all that move in them. For God will save Zion and rebuild the cities of Judah. Then people will settle there and possess it. The children of his servants will inherit it, and those who love his name will dwell there. Now, what was I thinking? This is a long psalm and a cursing psalm. This is a terrible psalm to preach on. We made it, though. I need to take a drink and a breath, though. So, David, he opens and he calls out to God. And in true poetic fashion, he describes this experience and this feeling of being overwhelmed, like deep waters are surrounding him. But not only is he overwhelmed by his circumstances, it's worse than that. He feels like God's not listening. Did you hear it? He talks about, I cry out for help. He cries out so much that his throat is getting dry, his vocal cords are tired. He's crying and crying for help, but it doesn't seem like God is anywhere to be found. His enemies outnumber the hairs on his head, he says. He has a number of enemies, and they are intent on ruining him. They have accused him of wrongs he did not commit. And he acknowledges that he's not innocent. He acknowledges, like, he has guilt, he's sinned, but he has not done what they've accused him of. And then, even his relationship with God is a source of mockery and scorn. They're shamed, they slander, they gossip about him. And so he pleads to God, deliver me, rescue me, come and help me. Come to my aid. God, help me. And then he turns to cursing his enemy. God, help me punish them. God, may the table where they sit and they think it's safe, and that place where you sit to eat food, may it be a trap. Like a mouse trying to get cheese but gets caught in a snare. May their table be a snare. Make them blind so they cannot see. May their spine be compressed. May they be childless. Withhold your salvation from them. In fact, God, while you're at it, why don't you just kill them? Remove them from the land of the living. This is where we read it and we're like, wait, what? What are we supposed to do with such a vindictive declaration of hate? A resume with C.S. Lewis, who in his book Reflections on the Psalms writes this. At the outset, I felt sure, and I feel sure still, that we must not either try to explain them away or yield one moment to the idea that because it comes in the Bible, all this vindictive hatred must somehow be good and pious. We must face both facts squarely. The hatred is there, festering, gloating, undisguised. And also, we should be wicked if we in any way condoned or approved it, or worse still, used it to justify similar passions in ourselves. So C.S. Lewis is saying we cannot explain it away. Like, we have to acknowledge and own the hatred is there. But just because it's in the Bible doesn't also mean we condone it. And we definitely don't use it as justification for our own hatred and resentment. And so, what do we do with this, though? How can that be? Well, one of the things we need to understand is that when we talk about Scripture being the Word of God, we believe it is revelation of who God is and His activity in the world. And that part of how God chose to reveal Himself in the written Word, He chose to reveal Himself through human authors. And He did not bypass the human authors. He did not bypass their language. He did not bypass their culture. He did not bypass their context. He didn't even bypass their personalities. But God actually chose to reveal Himself in and through these human agents. And so part of the revelation of God is not just the black and white words on the page, but actually the humans through whom God chose to reveal Himself through. But that is part of the revelation, and it reveals the activity of God who is in relationship with fallen, broken, sinful people. And so part of the revelation of Scripture is both the words that are written, but also the people and the context with whom God is in relationship with. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at Psalm 69, and we're going to ask ourselves, what does this reveal about the human and divine relationship? What does this psalm reveal? So first, we're going to look at the human part. What does this reveal about the human experience in relation to God? For those of you who like to take notes, I'll give you up front where we're going with this you see that there's crying out, there's complaining, there's cursing, but then there's converting to praise. There's crying out, the complaint, the curse, but it gets converted to praise. So one of the things this psalm reveals is that it is appropriate to direct our pleas for help to God. And not only is it appropriate to direct our cries for help to God, but I want to suggest that it's actually appropriate to be quite bold with it. David borders on the line of demanding from God that he show up and help him. God uses these imperative statements. Three times David writes, "Answer me. Answer me with your sure salvation," verse 13. "Answer me, Lord," verse 16. "Answer me quickly," verse 17. And he follows those imperative statements with statements like, "Rescue me, deliver me, save me, do not hide your face, come near, rescue me." When you feel overwhelmed, when your chest tightens with anxiety, when the chaos in your mind just doesn't seem to stop, when you are sure people are talking about you, misunderstanding you, when the conflict is not resolved with that friend or that family member, when people at work are slandering you with coworkers, cry out to God. And cry out boldly. And are we bold? Do we cry out with boldness to God because we're prideful or entitled or because God owes us something? No. The basis of our bold crying out to God is actually a faith and a confidence that He is mighty to save. It's because we are audacious enough to believe that we can cast all of our cares on God because He cares for us. So because we believe God cares, because we believe He's mighty to save, because we believe He is a refuge, we can come and say things like, "God, answer me, rescue me, deliver me, do not be far from me, come near to me." We can actually come to Him and boldly cry out, "God, help me." And do it quickly if you wouldn't mind. We bring our desperate cries for help. But we also see in Psalm 69 that we can bring our complaints to God. Most of us ruminate on the things we complain about anyways. We allow our complaints sometimes to reverberate in our minds, or we talk about it with other people. The thing is it's usually not fruitful. It usually is not redemptive. It usually doesn't go anywhere else except in our mind or in conversation with other people. But when we bring our complaints to God, it creates the opportunity for Him to work and move in and through. So give voice to your complaints. The appropriate way to convert your complaints into a prayer is by bringing them to God. So go ahead. Complain about your circumstances. Complain about the people who have hurt you, but just do it in God's presence. Complain to God, not just to others, but about others. Talk to God about it. Then we see the curse. Have you ever been hurt? I mean, like the stabbed in the back kind of hurt. And if you're honest, have you ever had that feeling where you wanted revenge? Have you perhaps even felt the emotion we might call hate? We wouldn't, of course, admit it in here. But you know what I'm talking about? Have you felt that? Here's the thing. God is intimately aware of your deepest, darkest, most horrifying innermost thoughts. He already knows how you feel. So there is no sense coming to God in prayer and trying to put on pious makeup in His presence. He already knows. And so go ahead. Bring that desire to revenge to God. If you simply voice that curse out in the open, you contribute to evil and brokenness. If you act on your desire for revenge, you contribute to injustice. But when we bring it before God, we create the opportunity and the space for it to be redeemed. And when we bring it into God's presence, there is potential and opportunity for Him to heal it.
There's no sense in hiding it from Him. He knows you. He knows your heart. He knows those thoughts and feelings that have crossed your mind. But it can be redeemed in His presence. Now, some of you are thinking, this feels like really bad advice. Our pastors told us to cry out to God with a demanding boldness, to complain, and to curse our enemies. Is this okay? I think so. I think there's these prayers modeled in the Psalms that invite us into this, but it doesn't usually stop there. That's the redemptive part. Like the laments, usually, not all the time, but usually end with a hymn of praise. And so we can convert our complaining and our cursing to worship by also praising God. By in the midst of our circumstances, and this is hard, and it's something we sometimes do by faith when we don't feel it, but in the midst of our circumstances, by faith, we praise God anyway. We worship anyway. And in that way, our laments become a form of worship as we praise God anyway. So, we cry out, we complain, we curse, in God's presence, and be praised. What does this reveal about God? The divine-human relationship. Well, we're going to talk about His character, His care, and the cross. The reason that the psalmist so boldly asks and are just almost downright demand that God come and help them is because of their confidence in His character. And I've thought about this before, but it's just so, once you see this, you will not unsee it in the Old Testament. It's so absolutely pivotal to an understanding of how the Israelites thought about God, and I'm going to revisit it. Their understanding of God's character was rooted in Exodus 34:6-7. To give you a brief context of the scene, the Israelites have been liberated from slavery in Egypt. They're at Mount Sinai. God is on the mountain with Moses, giving the covenant stipulations and the law and all this stuff. And Moses asked God to see His glory. God's like, here's the thing. It would overwhelm you. It would kill you. It's like staring at the sun. So I can't show you all of it. But I will pass by and I will declare my name. In the Hebrew idea, an ancient idea, like a name that carried the essence of someone's character, of their nature, of who they are. So God's going to pass by. And so, in Exodus 34, Moses gets up and climbs Mount Sinai, and the God of the universe passes. And we read this in 6 and 7. The Lord, is a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger and abounding in faithful love and truth, maintaining faithful love to 1,000 generations, forgiving iniquity, rebellion, and sin, but He will not leave the guilty unpunished, bringing the consequences of the father's iniquity on the children and grandchildren to the third and fourth generations. The scholars have noted how this is one of the most quoted scriptures in Scripture, in either whole phrases or even just parts. So kind of in the Hebrew mind, I've given the illustration, I borrowed this from a guy named Tim Mackey, but of hyperlinks. If you're familiar with the internet and how it works, a hyperlink, if you go to a website and you're reading an article, sometimes there will be a word that's highlighted or underlined. If you click on that, it will take you to another page with more information. Well, kind of in the Hebrew mind, especially with how thoroughly they knew the Torah, there are words or phrases or things that were like hyperlinks. And all throughout the Old Testament, there are hyperlinks back to Exodus 34:6-7. And so, are there hyperlinks in Psalm 69? There are. And if you can see it, it might be a little bit small, but I'm going to show them to you. Exodus 34:6, the Lord, the Hebrew name or the way the transliteration English is Yahweh. Yahweh is a compassionate, Raham, and gracious God, slow to anger and abounding in faithful love, it's chesed love, and truth, emet. In Psalm 69:13, but I pray to you, Yahweh. So anytime you see the capital Lord, it's the Hebrew name for God, Yahweh. And in the Israelite mind, it would always go. It's just always back to Exodus 34. Yahweh, Yahweh. This is how God introduces Himself. So even just that is a hyperlink to Exodus 34. Yahweh. in the time of your favor, in your great love. There it is, the chesed love. Answer me with your sure, some translations say true salvation, it's that emet word. Answer me, Yahweh, out of the goodness of your chesed again, in your great mercy, or raham, turn to me. The psalmists were anchored in the confidence of God's character, that he is gracious and compassionate and slow to anger and abounding in faithful love. And it's this chesed love. It's like this rock-solid covenant commitment that will pursue you even when you run away kind of love. It's just, there's not an English equivalent. Sometimes it's translated like loving kindness, but it may be like his faithful, enduring, covenant-keeping loving kindness would maybe be the best way to translate that one word. Is this the lens through which you see God the Father? Gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in a loving kindness that never gives up? Or is the lens through which you see the Father one of wrath and vengeance and punishment and disappointment? When you come to God, you come believing he's ashamed of you, and he's disappointed in you, and he's angry with you. If that's the primary lens through which you see God, of course you wouldn't dare to pray like this. You'd be too scared to. But if you know that God is gracious and compassionate and slow to anger and abounding in faithful, loving kindness, then you will come to him and you will boldly say, God, help me. God, deliver me. God, show up in my life. The psalm reveals God's character as rooted in Exodus 34, that he is gracious and compassionate and slow to anger and abounding in faithful love. Is that how you see God? It's how David saw God. How a lot of the other psalmists saw God. Because he's abounding in faithful love and kindness, the psalmists have this confidence that he also cares. I'm going to try to articulate this as best I can, but words fall short. Can you just imagine? The psalmists have the utmost confidence that the God of the entire cosmos cares about their individual lament. The God of the universe cares about what's going on in your story because he's gracious and compassionate and slow to anger and abounding in faithful love. And because he's abounding in faithful love and kindness, he cares. The psalm reveals that God cares about the things that grieve your heart. Again, that 2 Peter 5:7. Cast your cares on him because he cares for you. Hear me. God cares about the muck and the mire and the situations and the circumstances and the grief and the complaints and the hurts and the wounds that you have. God cares and God sees. Now, I cannot promise that God's going to remove you from it. I cannot stand up here and try to give you some sort of promise that God's going to show up in the way that you want and when you want on your timetable. I am not God. God is God, and that is not my role to stand here and say that. But it is my role to proclaim to you that I absolutely believe he cares about you. He cares about you. Because of his character, we see that he cares. But then we also see the cross. There's a little bit of a hyperlink from this psalm to Jesus on the cross. You probably missed it, but I'm going to highlight it for you. In verses 20 through 21 of Psalm 69, it says this: scorn has broken my heart and has left me helpless. I looked for sympathy, but there was none, for comforters, but I found none. They put gall in my food and gave me vinegar for my thirst. Let's go over to Matthew 27, Jesus on the cross. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and he forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. And in John 19:28-30, later, knowing that everything had been finished and so the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it and put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. David writes about his enemies treating him with scorn and bitterness and the emotional experience of having that much hatred directed towards him. He says it's like drinking bitter vinegar and bile. And David's response to his enemies is to curse them. But how are we as Christians, how are we as Jesus followers to respond? How does the cross convert the curse? Jesus became the curse. And when Jesus was literally given gall and vinegar to drink, how did he respond? Luke's gospel tells us. Luke 23:34. These are possibly some of the most offensive words of the gospel when we take them seriously. "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." The cross converts the curse. Miroslav Volf, I'm going to read a part of a quote from him, and I'm going to try to unpack it because it's pretty heady. He wrote this book called Exclusion and Embrace, and I would say about 70% of it, I'm not sure I understood. The 30% of it I did, he's an academic theologian, but the 30% I understood was just super transformative. He writes, "For the followers of the crucified Messiah, the main message of the imprecatory Psalms is this: rage belongs before God. Not in reflectively managed and manicured form of confession, but as a pre-reflective outburst from the depths of the soul. This is no mere cathartic discharge pent-up aggression before Almighty, who ought to care. Much more significantly, by placing unattended rage before God, we place both our unjust enemy and our own vengeful self face to face with the God who loves and does justice. Hidden in the dark chambers of our hearts and nourished by the system of darkness, hate grows and seeks to infest everything with its hellish will to exclusion. In the light of the justice and love of God, however, hate receives, and the seed is planted for the miracle of forgiveness." He goes on with these really profound words to talk about forgiveness flounders because we have a way of removing ourselves from being in the same category as our enemies. We remove ourselves from sinful humanity and we stand in the judgment seat. And so long as we are in the judgment seat and our enemies are monsters and they are sinners and we are not, we cannot forgive. But when we come before God and we bring our injustice in the face of the God of the crucified Messiah, who is also love and justice, we are confronted with the reality that we are as deserving of justice as our enemies. We come face to face with the reality that unless we want to remove ourselves from the rest of humanity and presume that we have never hurt anyone, we have never contributed to injustice, we have never sinned, unless we want to remove ourselves from that category, we have to acknowledge we too are sinners. And so we bring our rage and our injustice into the presence of God. And we're able to rediscover our enemy's humanity. And when our enemies aren't simply monsters that we've dehumanized, but they're human, like us, that's when our hearts are fertile for the miracle of forgiveness. As we stare at the cross, and we realize that God in Christ was not counting man's sin against him, but he was reconciling all things to himself, 2 Corinthians 5. We'll find, when we come to God's presence, staring at the God of the crucified Messiah, staring at the cross, we will find that we are face to face with the mystery of forgiveness. Because we'll find that it's there, we are. When we stand face to face with the crucified Messiah, we will find that he will hear our person. He is patient, and he will hear it. But he will bid us to come and follow. And following Jesus always leads to the cross, where we crucify the old self with its passions and desires, with its hatred and resentment. And so at the cross, we will hear these words. Forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Freely you have received, now freely give. And that is one of the hardest things about the gospel. The cross converts the curse. And so what do we do in preparatory psalms in the Old Testament? We read them backwards from the lens